Hey guys, this is Neil with Xclass Machine Works, and this is the frame assembly build video for our Cannonball 800 Xclass Monster. This video is going to cover the frame assembly itself. We're not going to get into the electronics installation into this guy. If you are building up a Cannonball, you know what you're doing, right? This is not intended for somebody that's relatively new getting into FPV quads. This is for the experienced builder who knows what he or she is doing. All right, so let's go ahead and start. What I've got here is the bottom plate. Here is the bill of material. This is the bottom plate here. And then I've also grabbed a few fasteners, these that I have marked. I've got this screw. This is a large flange button head screw. We've got an M3 washer and a couple spacers. This is them listed here. Okay, so what you want to do is look for the captive nut that's pressed into the bottom of the plate there and build up this little assembly. All right, so the first thing you're going to do is take the smaller spacer, run it on here on the screw, take the bigger spacer like that, and the washer, this, and then go ahead and screw it down. Go. So the purpose of this little sub-assembly there is a catch for the lipo tray. Once you've got all the lipo tray components, this stops this from moving forward. So the next step is to install the rest of the lipo tray components onto the bottom plate. I've got them all laid out here, and I'll show you which ones they are on the bill. All right, so I've got them marked. So all of these red 3D printed parts, there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in total. Look like that. And I've got this thumb screw and a little spring. That's them there. And we've got a lot of fasteners here. So these are little Phillips head, half-inch long silver screws. And if I can grab my frame, this is what the lipo tray assembly is going to look like once it's installed. So you can see it there. All right, so let's get started. This is actually laid out. Let me move these. This is laid out how this thing is going to sit on the bottom plate. So the front of the craft is with this little assembly here pointing forward. And these are to be laid out in this direction. So we'll start on the bottom left corner. Okay, and there's these screw holes right here. Not these, but those three right there. You're going to line up with these holes. Okay, so you flip it over. So go ahead and screw these down. Now you don't want to tighten them all the way up. What you want to do is get them there and then back off a little bit, and I'll show you why later. So what you want right now is for this thing to slide around a little bit. So we'll go ahead and put the other components on. Now this one here lines up with these three holes. This one, and this one.
It's gonna be the same situation for all of these red components. These slide components is don't tighten it up all the way.
And you've got these three holes here. We'll line that up. All right, so the reason we wanted to leave those loose is go ahead and fit the tray in here. Make sure that it slides correctly and nothing's binding up. And then once you've got it in there, you can go ahead and tighten these down. There we go. On to the next step. The next step is to install this component and this little release block. This spring and this thumb screw. The way that it works, I'll show you my assembled base here. You've got a little thumb screw right here that you can grab and you can pull out and spring loaded. And then on the other side is this little component here. So we'll go ahead and assemble that. And you need to look at this block and pay attention to its geometry. So there is actually an angle right here, okay? There is a mating angle on this face. You want those angles to match up, like that. So the angle's in this direction, pointing towards the front of the craft. The reason for that is you want this angle because when this tray wants to slide back, it catches that angle and it pulls this little component in this direction instead of trying to push it in this direction. Okay, so that's an important, it's a very small detail, but it's important. So pay attention to which direction this block is oriented. Now, there is a little hole here. You've got to get these threads into this hole. Okay, so what we've done when we printed this is this hole is too small for this. The reason for that is we need a good tight fit on these screws on these threads into this little hole. So what you can do, what I do is take an M3 tap and go ahead and tap this hole. It's plastic, so it's very easy to do. And you may be going, whoa, wait a minute. Hold on a second there, Catalyst Machine Works. I gotta have a tap? What are you talking about? Well, you're an experienced builder and you need to have an M3 tap. This is your opportunity to get a tap. We're forcing you. All right, so we'll go ahead and finish tapping this thing. You can go to any auto parts store and probably find an M3 tap. Go to Lowe's. Pretty common stuff. All right, now that I have tapped that hole, I'm going to go ahead and this is just pre-fitting this screw in here. I'm going to run it in. Now, you don't have to have a tap, right? I'm partially kidding. You can get, you know, you don't have to have one of these. You could get an X-Acto knife and kind of whittle out the hole, or a soldering iron, or whatever way you want to do it. But a tap is the best way to accomplish this. All right, go ahead and thread this thing in here like this. All right, then we'll go ahead and remove it. Now that we've done that, I'm going to run this in here, install the spring, and then go ahead and install this back. Make sure that this angle I was talking about is pointed in this direction. Alright, now that you've got this installed, go ahead and fit this up. Line up these holes. And what you want to do is make sure that when these holes are lined up and the tray is in place and it's all the way forward, that you can actually slide this out. It doesn't get stuck. Alright. It could be possible that you're going to have to remove a little bit of material, just a little touch of material like I did here, so that you can get it to slide like this. What we did is we added a little bit too much material on this face because we don't want this assembly to be loose. So we'd rather you go and have to remove just a touch of material to get this thing to slide properly, and instead of this thing being sloppy. All right, so this is, you know, this is plastic, so it's super easy to remove. I think I removed probably a quarter of a millimeter of material there to get this thing to slide out like this. All right, so what we'll do next is go ahead and install those screws. All right, now that we've got that installed, what I'm going to do is just test this interface, make sure that it slides out properly. You can get the tray in and out. You should be able to slide this forward, and you hear that snap. Is that not satisfying? I don't know why that is so sad. I love hearing that. Ready? Oh my God. Okay, that was pretty nerdy. Sorry, I let my nerd out just then. Let's do it one more time. Ready? Oh my goodness. Next step is to install these M4 standoffs with these screws. I'll show you where they are on the bill of material. This one right here, these are M4 by 12 millimeter. I'm sorry, here they are here. Oops. These are M4 by 12 millimeter. And then the standoffs are here. They're 35 millimeter long. So pretty simple. Basically look for these M4 holes. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then obviously mirror it on the other side. Go ahead and install those. You don't need to fully tighten them down just yet. Just get them in place. Everything is seated correctly later.
I don't know about you, but assembling something with components this large, playing with large components like this, is very exciting. There's just something about it. I don't know what it is.
All right, so now that we've got everything installed, we'll go back and tighten these up. Now, after you get the frame completely assembled, you should go back through all the screws and make sure that everything is torqued correctly. This is going to try and spin on you, and you're not going to be able to torque it all the way down until you get the top plate installed. So you'll have to go back through later and make sure that these are all tightened correctly, torqued up. All right, in this step, these are the components we'll be using. We're going to have these, this is a top plate side, this one and this one. Obviously, our sub-assembly from the previous steps. We're going to get 16 clamp halves and then 16 screws. So they are right here. So we'll go ahead and get started. Oh, forgot to mention that we're also going to get 4 of the arms. We'll bring those in a bit later. So what you want to do is just go ahead and drop these screws in the holes, like so. Alright, now a little trick that I use is I'll take and I will hold all these down and flip it over on the table. Just like that. Okay, you can go ahead and start putting in the, start putting in the clamps. All right, we've got the bottom halves of the clamp pairs installed. Next step is to grab four of the arms. The arms are the shorter of the bunch, so they're going to come packed like this. Obviously, if you purchased the version of the frame that doesn't have any braces, you're just going to get these four. If you got the one that comes with the braces, you're going to get two longer ones, and the braces are longer than the arms. Okay, so go ahead and get these out of these bags. All right, I've taken them out of the bags. I'm going to go ahead and install these, just press them into place. What you want to do is make sure that this is sort of comes up against these 3D printed parts like this.
And just rest up against them. Okay.
Now that we've got that done, you're going to take and install that. Now, there's a number of ways to do this. What you can do is you can put these on here, right? You can take and sort of hold all this assembly and then quickly flip it over to access the other side, or you can take and sort of shift this to the edge of a table and then reveal each screw one by one and then just screw them in. However you want to do it, you'll figure it out. So I'm going to go ahead and do that off camera. All right, so I've got all of the clamps tightened down. The arms are installed. Now, a bit of important information is when you are torquing down on these screws and seating these clamps and tightening all this down, don't over tighten this stuff, okay? How this thing works is it's taking these two clamps and pulling them towards each other and grabbing this arm. There's also a slight bit of force going in this direction, in towards the center of the arm. If you continue to over tighten these screws, it's possible to put too much force here in the center and you'll start to hear cracking in the carbon fiber if you go too tight. If you hear that, you know, when you're tightening this thing down, slowly tighten them evenly, a little bit on this side, a little bit on this side, and go back and forth until you get it seated and torqued down. If you hear any cracking, back off. You're done. All right, you're probably not going to, but that happened to me one time. And it wasn't it's not a manufacturing defect with the arm. It's just I had over-tightened it. So you'll know when they're nice and tight, and you'll get a feel for it. So that's what it looks like at the end of this. Now we're going to install the motor mounts. There are two different versions of this frame. There is a version with no front and rear brace. And then there's the version, obviously, with the front and rear brace. So what I'm going to show you first is how to install the motor mounts for the version without braces. And obviously what you're going to want to do when you've got your motor is go ahead and install. You got to install the motor onto the top plate, of course. Then you can install the complete motor mount onto the end of the arm. So I'm sure it'll come as no surprise how this goes together. All right, so this is where the components exist on the bill. We've got the top mount, bottom mount, and then of course more clamps and screws. So what I'm going to do is just install one motor mount, and then of course it's the same for every arm. We'll take the bottom plate, run those screws in. All right, off camera, I went ahead and torqued these things down properly. That's what she's gonna look like. Now, I do wanna point out, there's two different ways you can run the wires from your motor. You can run the wires through this little hole, through this hole, and then through the front of the arm. Or you could just run it down the arm, however you wanna do it. What we're going to do is take the top plate. We're calling it the top plate middle here on the bill, right there. We need some fasteners. So we've got M4 by 16 millimeter screws. These are button head screws. We've got M4 washers. There's four of them. And then M4 nylock nuts. So that's them there. Then on the other side of the bill, we've got these two components, the front cage hinge, and did I spell that incorrectly? Ooh, man, English isn't my first language, apparently. And then the rear cage mount. So that's them there. So let's go ahead and put these together. This is going to go in like this. We're going to come in from the bottom. Want to make sure and get those screws nice and tight. You also need to make sure that this thing is straight. There's going to be a little slop in it, so you may have to adjust that. Looks like I actually need to adjust that, so I'll do that off camera. All right, I've got that nice and straight. Now the next step is to go ahead and install this guy. Goes through these screws here, or those holes there. Make sure that this is straight, okay, then you can go ahead and tighten it down. And there we go. But now we've got this top plate partially assembled, we'll go ahead and move on to the cage. I've got one here. This is what it's going to look like. when it's done. So the components on this guy are, this first one is the flight controller mount. We've got the FPV camera mount, the two fuselage side plates. We've got these standoffs. These are M3 by 40 millimeter standoffs right here. We've got some screws. These are M3 by 8 millimeter button head screws on here somewhere. I can't find them right now, but I promise they're there. This is, this right here is a VTX mount and a RX antenna mount, if you desire, right here. So let's go ahead and get started. All right, so how this works, open this up. First, what we'll do is go ahead and start installing the standoffs. Now there's only four standoffs, but there's a bunch of holes. So you can kind of tinker with where you want to place them. I have a preferred set of locations where I put them, but it is up to you how you want to do it, depending on your electronics and hardware configuration. Loose. This VTX mount is going to mount and it's going to be fastened in here. There's a little radius here that goes to the back, and then this flat part is on the top like this, and it lines up with these two holes there.
Take these Phillips head screws, these are steel half inch long Phillips head screws, and we'll run those in.
Now I'll go back through and go ahead and tighten these guys down. That is how that works out. I want to make sure that these two plates are not moving around, that they're tight. This one should be absolutely immobile. You know, you shouldn't be able to move this. Should not slide. This one may move a touch, but once you install this onto the craft, and you have your screw running through here, it will compress this plate and it won't move. All right, we're gonna go ahead and install the cage onto the top plate. And to do that, I'm gonna use these two M4 by 50 millimeter steel socket screws. Then I'm also gonna use two more of these oversized M4 washers right here. So how this works is, sit on here like this, And then you've got your M4 captive nuts in the back. Let me see if I can find the right Allen wrench size here. Want to go ahead and tighten this one down pretty tight, but you'll still be able to rotate this cage up and down to open it up like that. Okay, and then obviously how this thing works in the rear is the same. You got another screw running through here. And this screw will run into the other captive nut and lock the assembly in place. And there you have it. So if you want to gain access to these electronics here a little bit easier, you can pull this screw and then rotate this up like this. And I said I wasn't going to discuss any of the electronics installation specifics, but I think it would make sense to go ahead and give you some details, considering we give you all of these nylon fasteners. These are all for mounting in the electronics to this cage and to the top plate. So we've given you a different selection of parts, and we think that what we've provided here will pretty much cover any type of configuration you can come up with. All right, so I'll start with the FPV camera. So for the FPV camera, there are a couple of options. Option one is using these right here. These are M2 by 12 millimeter screws. And then we've got M3 by 6 millimeter black nylon spacers. I've got them mounted in on this cage example here. Let me get this in a light bit better. So the way that it works, obviously, is you've got the screws running through here. Oh, I forgot to mention, there are in your kit some little M2 washers. I've got two washers here per screw. All right, that gets the perfect length, I found, to get into the camera. And this is a standard HS1177 size camera here. Okay, and then you use the nylon washers. Whoop! Use the nylon washers here. I'm sorry, the nylon spacers here to space the camera out. And it's everything else is pretty much self-explanatory. Now, this option I found tends to work the best. I mean, this camera is absolutely mounted. It's planted in here. It's not going anywhere. And it's really easy to adjust the angle on the camera just by loosening these two screws here. All right. Now, there is another option to mount your camera if you don't want to go that route. Most of these cameras, especially the bigger cameras, come with a little bracket. It's a little flexible aluminum bracket. It's a pretty bad material. That's why I don't use it. But if you want to do it, have at it. You can mount it here. We've got the little slots that the screws can run through. We don't provide you the fasteners to make this happen. Usually that comes in the along with the camera. So that's how that works. All right, the next bit I'm going to discuss has to do with all of those nylon fasteners that I was mentioning. Here they are here. Okay. So, there are a couple of ways. Let me restart. There is one way to mount the power distribution board in, and that is right here. You can see that these are standard 30.5 by 30.5 holes. And there is sets so you can move the PDB back and forward and back. All right. These screws here, these are M3 by 18 millimeter screws. They come up through the bottom like this. All right, then you can mount your power distribution board. And oops, I forgot to mention, there are these little black spacers. These are nylon spacers. I suggest to use two per screw. That gets that power distribution board spaced up off of the carbon properly. You don't want that power distribution board too low. If you get it too low, set this down, move this stuff out of the way. If you get it too low, when you are soldering to the power distribution board, it's possible, like on this one, this is a advanced power drives, that the solder can actually seep down through these holes and touch the carbon. And then everything goes up in a glorious ball of flames when you when you plug in for the first time. So you don't want that. All right. Now we can put the power distribution board in there like that. Okay. So with that said, this leads me to the flight controller. All right, the flight controller can mount in two locations. You can either mount it to this plate using the other fasteners, or you can mount it right here. All right. If you want to mount it to the PDB, what you can do is take these little standoffs that we've provided. Then you want to cut down these screws. All right, so position this in here and figure out how low you need to cut down the screws, right? Then you can run these onto the screws and then you can mount your flight controller. So up to you how you want to do it. That leads me to another subject, okay? And this is what we found in testing. I don't know if I've mentioned this to anyone, but this is a good opportunity. So by design, I had originally designed that the HD cameras would mount up here on the top of this cage. That's what this is for. We found that when we had the flight controller mounted to this plate and we would fly the craft, that there was a pendulum effect because of the weight up here on top of this cage. It would take, and the vibrations from the motors would take and slightly jostle this this cage back and forth. The flight controller would sense it because it was mounted on the cage as well, and then it would try and correct, and it would fight that movement, and then it would start this this cyclic movement and vibration that we'd pick up in the HD camera. So we set out to design other places to mount the HD camera to resolve that issue, and it did. It resolved that issue. Now, with that said, I suspect, and I haven't tested this yet, I suspect that if you take, and instead of mounting your flight controller here, you mount it here, okay, it may be possible to run your HD camera up here. I don't know. I hadn't tested it yet. Maybe one of you guys can test that. Let me know what you find out. So there's that. Now, obviously, if you decide you want to go ahead and mount your flight controller up here, you know, I wouldn't suggest to mount it on the top. I would mount it on the bottom. And the way that you would do that is you'll use these little Phillips head M3 by 6mm long screws, and you just run them. Oop, if I can get them in there. Okay, you're just going to run them in this hole like this. All right, I'm just going to do one. And then the flight controller is going to hang like this, right? Okay, and then obviously you're going to use your nut to hold it down, hold it on. So that's how that works. All right, the next step has to do with these black grommets here. Those are listed right here on the bill. And what these are for, so these are for passing wires up through this top plate or down through the top plate. All right. And there's no specific right way to do this. We just provided these pass-throughs as a, hey, they're there if you want them kind of thing. You don't have to use them. You don't have to install these if you don't want. I'll show you one configuration that we've done on an existing craft. Now you have to, I have to apologize. This one is actually being rebuilt. But this is my machine right here. Cannonball, son. Oh my goodness. Check that out. I'm sorry, I had to stop and just a little show off minute here. Ooh. Oh, get your nerd all juiced up on that one, hmm? Yes, sir. All right, so, okay. So the way that we've got this thing set up is we've only got one grommet, and then coming off the PDB here is the main lipo pigtails. So this is obviously the negative, and then, my God, this thing is huge. Okay, and then we've got the positive running down here, and then you run that out to your battery there, okay? Now, you can do it that way, or you can mount these in here, and if you wanted to mount the ESCs on the side of the craft, and then run wires, the power wires from the ESCs up to the PDB, you can use them for that. But for the purposes of this video, I'll show you how to install a couple of these. Just maybe get something that's blunt. Don't use something sharp. And be careful when you're installing them so you don't scratch the carbon. But you basically just work it in like that. And that's pretty much it. So if you want to talk to me about how to get one of those wraps like I just showed you, we're going to be making those available soon. So you can email us at info@catalystmachineworks.com or support@catalystmachineworks.com, and we can discuss one of those wraps and get one of those out to you. So that's how that works. Okay. One bit I forgot to mention is how the VTX mount works. So there is, open this up, there is a hole right here where you can run your antenna into. I'll show you what that looks like on my craft. Okay, you can see it here. If I move this stuff out of the way, you can see how we've got it there. Now, there are also these little nubs here. And what you can do, now we don't provide this in the kit because, I mean, frankly, you need to be running crossfire on this system. A heavy, expensive, dangerous system like this needs to have crossfire. For the love of God, please use crossfire. But if for some reason, for some god-awful reason, you decide you don't want to use crossfire, well, we went ahead and put these little things in here. And these are, you can put antenna tubes in here and then run up, you know, like a standard XSR or XM Plus or something like that. Some type of standard receiver. So that's how that works. All right, I said I wasn't going to discuss the electronics, but there's just so much going on with this thing. And we have so much available to you guys that I need to discuss this portion. So this is the ESC here. This is the one we like to use. This is a Advanced Power Drives. This is their 120 amp ESC. If you're running an Xclass, these are the guys to go to, right? I don't trust anything but this. This is a very high end unit. It is expensive, right? This is an expensive piece of electronics, but it's worth it, in my opinion. So, how do you mount in the ESCs? Well, we've designed in kind of a preferred method. Of course, you can mount them anywhere you want to mount them, but we provide an optional accessory on our website. This is a mount specifically designed for this ESC, And the way that it works is you just place it in here like this. There's these little lips that go over, and they just hold it in place. So there's no fasteners, there's no zip ties, there's nothing like that, putting unwanted pressure on the components. And then what you do is there's holes in the top plate, and you run your screws in. I think we sent out a mass email explaining the different accessories that we have available to you guys for this Cannonball. And a number of people purchased these, but about half of you guys who pre-ordered did not. You might want to consider these because they work really, really well. They protect the ESC from, no, they help to protect the ESC from damage. They keep it insulated from the carbon. They position the thing correctly. They're just really nice. Of course, you can mount your ESCs to the arms or the side of the craft somehow, or whatever ways you come up with, but this is a dedicated way to do it here. I'm only going to put in one. Of course, there's one here, there, and there for all four ESCs. Keeps them on this top plate. So that's how that works. Mounts it in really nicely. Now it's time to install this top portion onto the base. And to do that, we're going to use these fasteners here. So what we've got are these screws, right? So depending on how you're going to configure the connection of the top plate to the base determines which of these you're going to use. So these are the same size. They're both M4, but one of them is 25 millimeters long and one's 35 millimeters long, right? So you get 8 of each. I am going to use the shorter ones. These are the 25 millimeter, but I've got one of the 35 millimeter here. So that's what it's going to look like. We'll get it out of the way. And how this works are there are a number of spacers here. This is them here. They're little knurled black aluminum spacers. They're unthreaded. And on the bill, let's see if I can find them. Here they are here. Okay. And we provide enough that you can configure this thing in different ways. So what you want to do, you've got the base, and then your lithium batteries are mounting to here. They're going to have a certain height. So you use those spacers to space this top plate up or down. Then, of course, if you've got it higher, you're going to need the longer screws. You've got it lower, you're going to need the shorter screws. So that's how that works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to install a height of 2 spacers per location. They go right here and right here. So we'll go ahead and do that now. Let me see if I can get this situated. Okay, and the easy way to do it is just put in, not all of them at the same time, just do it like that. And then we'll put in these 4. Over here, like this. Then you can carefully position this guy down.
In place, like that. And you can run your screws in.
Okay, so these are ready to be tightened down. These are not hex head, these are Torx screws. Again, you're a professional builder, you've got Torx ready to go. I'm back and I've got my Torx driver. This is a T20. Yes. Ooh, ooh, ooh. That's a T20. I'm going to go ahead and torque these down. It take a little pressure. You've got to seat the screws into the threads on those standoffs. What you want to do is go ahead and run them in, but not all the way. Don't torque them down yet, because you got to find the threads here on all of the screws. So now, go ahead and torque these guys down. And there we have it. It's hard to get this big thing in the camera shot, but that's how that works. So if you've got bigger, taller batteries, you can put another spacer in there and use the longer screws and get some more space. All right, guys, so that brings a close to the Cannonball frame build video. And there's something that I want to stress to you guys who are going to be flying this. Please be careful. Please use your best judgment. This is a very expensive, large, dangerous machine. So don't do anything stupid. Like the legend of the Phoenix, all ends with beginnings. What keeps the planet spinning?